Hello everyone, I'm Abid Hassan, Senior Assistant Editor with ETHR World, and a very warm welcome to the first edition of ETHR World Talent 4.0 Summit. And our theme is Imperative of the New Age Talent Acquisition. I have with me senior HR leaders, and we are going to discuss a very important topic, connecting the dots between candidate experience, onboarding, and employer branding to attract the best talent. In this panel, we'll be discussing how these elements have their significance in attracting the best talent. In the last 1 year, everything has changed, especially the workplace. People leaders are more sensitive towards candidate experience and the virtual onboarding. Employers are focusing more and more on their employer branding, how to enhance employer branding, how things have changed, what are the challenges, where do we see the opportunity, and is it going to stay? To discuss these things in details, I welcome all of you to this panel discussion. My first panelist is Ms. Anjali Raghuvanshi, Chief People Officer, Randstad India. Hello, Anjali, and welcome to the panel discussion.
Thank you, Abhay.
Thanks a lot. My next panelist, Raksha Agarwal, Head TA SAP. Welcome, Raksha.
Thank you, Abhay.
My next panelist is Abhijit Abhyankar, Regional Head of People, South Asia, Middle East and Africa, Cathay Pacific. Welcome to the panel, Abhijit.
Hi, Abhijit. Thanks for inviting and happy to be on this panel. Thank you.
Thanks. And my last panelist for this session is Satyajit Mohanty, CHRO, Crompton Greaves Consumer Electricals. Welcome, Satyajit.
Hello.
Welcome to the panel, everyone. It's my pleasure to have all of you. Since I have said that today we are going to talk about candidate experience and onboarding, especially virtual onboarding and employer branding. So my first question is for you, Satyajit. The most common complaint that candidates have about their job application experience is that companies never get back to them. They never reach out to them when it comes to post-interview. What do you think, you being a people leader, being an industry expert, how employers, how companies, or how people leaders should design the right candidate experience strategy? And what role can technology play to ease this out? What are your thoughts?
I go back about a couple of years back when I was in US and Canada. So something I saw, practically speaking, which kind of puzzled me. There are some cases where a candidate applies. In case he or she doesn't get selected, he gets a response. In some cases from the same company, he doesn't get a response. In some cases he gets a response, some case doesn't respond. Puzzled me a lot. Came back to India, right? Because I keep on traveling. So I saw the same stuff happening in India and many of the companies, some of the companies have had. Now, delve a bit deeper through by talking to those companies. And even more critical, talking to the consultant, like Anjali is from Randstad. I'm talking, we work a lot with companies such as Conferry, Hydric Struggles, Transearch. We also work a lot of these companies. So I tried understanding why it is like this. Most of the time, people don't get a response when they are not selected. In some case, in the same company, they get a response. In some case, they don't get a response. What transpired is extremely interesting. Now, what happens in US and Canada is, a lot of the CV sourcing operations are AI enabled. So you put in your CV through a system, Indeed or whatever the platforms are. It has got algorithms which spits out CV which get shortlisted and spits out the CV which doesn't get shortlisted. And the system sends an auto reply to the candidates, very polite mail, you know, we are looking for something different, blah, 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 right? However, once the candidate goes past the screening test, it gets into what I call the human error zone. And that is the time when all this professional or ethical view of getting back to candidate, if in the case he or she doesn't get selected, fails. When I spoke to these companies, including companies which are extremely strong on data and technology, so I asked them why it is like this. And ask another question, which are your views when I speak to those companies, big headhunters, in your views, which are the companies who do it? The answer is very, very sobering. The first answer is, the reason they don't do it is primarily driven by a simple factor called indifference. There is more where the candidate is coming from. Forget about the junior and middle management cadres, even for senior levels. They say, yeah, theek hai yaar abhi, hua nahi abhi. So that is a big factor, the indifference plays into the role or not getting at the candidate. Nobody looks at the human element of the stuff, that here is a person who has invested, he has come with a lot of hope in his heart, and he or she has gone through a process, invested his time, so he reserves a reply. Now, there are a couple of companies that cited, I will not take the names obviously, who actually do it. So I asked them, what prompts them to do it? Including some of the Indian tech giants, they will do it for some of the positions. It is driven by a simple business consideration called candidate pool. And what is the likelihood that I will see this person again 6 months next? There is one company, Middle East, who does very rigorous because Middle East talent market is extremely limited. They don't have a choice but keep the good candidates in good humor, even if they don't find suitable, because after 6 months, they may need them. Same for some of the tech giants in India who do it. So the coming back to the short point is, technology doesn't replace human intentions. And it is a sobering part that so many companies, including the company, extremely process-oriented company, don't think of this professional ethical dimension. So in this case, when I ask myself, I can have approaches as they have in US or Canada, the tech giants, that whether the CV happens, automatic something goes to candidates. Okay, your CV is not shortlisted. That, in my view, is a very mechanical way of looking at candidate experience. So my view in this matter is, first and foremost, is people like us, in fact, in my company also, don't get back to candidate consciously. I'm the CHRO for the company. I also don't think like this. So long as people like us who are supposed to implement new cultural change and practices start understanding the business case of doing this specific activity, enabling technology is just like doing a tick mark in the box. We have a lot of technology possibilities which can get back to candidates, but that will not replace the lack of human sensitivities by many of our display on this specific topic. And why I say it is, this practice is ramp, in my view, what I've seen and what these headhunters and VCs seen is extremely prevalent across industries, across countries. So the answer is not as simple as enable technology and the entire landscape changes. So that would be my two bits on this specific topic, Abhil.
Thank you, Satyajit. You mentioned about technology and about AI that you highlighted. But Abhijit, coming to you, we all understand, undoubtedly, companies do want to offer candidates a memorable experience. There's no doubt about it. But I would like to ask you, how can companies be sure that it was a wonderful experience for the candidates or people they are interviewing? What are the top metrics to gauge candidate experience?
So that's a great question, actually, Abid. And you use the word undoubtedly, and I would say, yes, undoubtedly, it is important, especially for a company like Cathay Pacific, because we actually invest a lot of time and money in making it sure and ensuring that our candidates get that experience. So, just to give you an example, it starts right from the time that the candidate is actually coming and visiting our websites. We have a website called the Careers website, and it has a host of information. Then it also moves to how we are contacting the candidates once they're shortlisted and how is the people team interacting with them. And then we have something called as the assessment center. So we don't have an interview. It basically is like an assessment center, which actually is a full day exercise for those shortlisted candidates. And it's a very conscious effort from our side to basically call these candidates to our office and give them a feel. So it's a full day thing. So it gets them to interact with the senior leadership. It also gets them, when they have the free time, to actually see the culture of the company, what's going on, because they're actually experiencing it when they're waiting for their chance to come in. So all the more it is really important that we make sure that this experience where we are investing so much is actually a good experience. So traditionally there are certain metrics that we can always look at. One is the amount of applications that have come for that position. And that's a very straightforward matrix. How many are suitable for the position and how many are not. Out of the applications that you've got, how many actually qualify, how many overqualify. That is one of the matrix that we are looking at. The other matrix also is and is that for the particular job, in the past, how many people have you really offered those positions? How many have how many have accepted right on the first go. But I guess the key for us to actually looking at this is to actually get a direct feedback from them. So we have a two-step feedback process. One process is on the day of the assessment center, we take a feedback from them. And we also know that, you know, probably because they're applying, their feedback could actually skew towards, you know, giving us the positive information. But we've designed the questionnaire in such a way that, we can actually pick up the finer nuances to see whether, was that experience a good experience or not. But the second bit also is to get a complete unbiased opinion. It happens when the candidate actually joins the company. So we have a full policy in place where, we have a buddy who's attached to that candidate, and it's a 3-month whole process. And in that 3 months, we have, specific points, data points where, we will always, encourage the line manager to talk to the candidate to find out, how has that experience been. So I think it's pretty simple for us that, we will need to look at not only the traditional matrix, but also, real-time feedback to understand whether the experience is being just like the way we wanted or not. And I can happily put a point out here that for the last couple of years, we've got real good feedback and we've been able to just enhance our onboarding experience.
Coming back to Anjali, more you are handling more of HR consulting and when starting to do more of HR consulting, I would like to ask you, How the candidate experience has changed in the last 1.5 years with everything virtual? How, as a people manager, you have changed your approach towards the new recruitment? It would be great if you can share some example for the same.
It's been great listening to Satyajit and Abhijit. I think we spoke about the experience part. I mean, one of the bigger aspect of experience is also the response, right, that we give back to our candidates. And that definitely is something I would say is less of indifference, Satyajit. It's more of the, when you deal with volumes, right, it gets very difficult for you to reach out to each and every one. And that's where I would say technology plays a role, right, by ensuring that there is some touch points that you manage. But coming to candidate experience, I think one piece I would like to say, and I think this has been the reality, but probably we woke up to the reality a bit later. Talent scarcity is something within the HR fraternity we always speak about, but that also means that it is a candidate market, right, out there. Whereas there is very little that's being spoken and done from a candidate experience. We talk a lot about our employee experience. So I think one of the things which at Randstad we've kind of tried imbibing and bringing in our culture is the human forward experience. And this is where we talk about the tech and the touch of it. And everybody thinks that it's only tech. So if you get chatbots, if you get AI, it's all done. But it's at the end of the day, it's about how you make a candidate feel in the entire process. And it begins from the very first touch point that happens. And just the way your employees look out for meaningful experiences within the organization, your candidate also has a trigger point why he applied or she applied for a job. So I think one of the most important things for recruiters is to really look at those trigger points. For some, it's sheer compensation. For some, it's really looking out for challenging opportunities, because we all of us are in different phases of life and we look for different things. So we have something called 3 pillars of a human forward experience. One is guidance. The second one is transparency. And the third one is proactivity. Guidance is a lot about really helping them understand at this point in career, what is it that they are looking for, what works best for them. And that also helps you know the candidate well. So you will then design the engagement right. For someone who's only looking for compensation, how much ever touch points you create at the end of the day, that is what that matters, right? But so for someone, say, suppose they're looking for learning, then you make them meet the right stakeholders to get that sort of experience, like as Abhijit said about the buddy program. So the buddy can actually expose them to that. Then comes transparency. It's about really being open in the entire process. And we keep talking about being honest with the candidate. Sometimes we get like, okay, if I am going to say this to him, he's going to get very defensive or she's going to question the process. So we hold back the honesty in the feedback, which is very important, because this is also a development process in a way. I have heard so many candidates come to me and say that the interview process was a very enlightening process for them. They actually got to know a lot about themselves, right? So then it's our duty to give the honest feedback. So that's transparency. Proactivity is about really kind of proactively getting back to them. rather than always being like someone's chasing you. I'm sure once you filter down, you're dealing with only 4 or 5 candidates, right? So getting back to them should not be a challenge. Just getting back to 100 could be, right? So I think these are the things which we constantly train our recruiters to start following. I wouldn't say that it's so easy that it is happening everywhere. It is also about really building it and making it as part of their DNA. It's an ongoing process. And I think if these three mantras we feel if we follow as a recruiter, you are going to end up giving a great experience to your candidate. And then of course you design the whole engagement around it and make them feel special. And it's possible, especially with technology coming into the play heavily now, gives you the time and the bandwidth. So that would be my reaction to the candidate experience piece.
Thanks Anjali for sharing those three pointers. This will be really helpful for the people who are listening to this session. And coming to the second part of this discussion, which is employer branding, which I think which is very important, and it has become more important in the last few years. So, Braksha, I'll come to you. I have a very important and basic question for you. How people leaders or employer organization can build an effective employer value proposition to attract the right candidates? Would you like to share some key metrics?
Definitely, Abid. And I think it's a very pertinent question in today's scenario. It goes without saying that a strong EVP, which is the employer value proposition, helps differentiate a brand from its competitors. Even if there's an overall employer brand, in today's context, companies are looking at tailoring their messages to highlight the factors that are appealing to a particular audience. For instance, where the audience is multi-generational, multicultural, et cetera. Now, for instance here, if I talk about a technologist, what tech stacks an organization works on, how IT savvy that organization is, will matter to a technology person more than a salesperson probably. Similarly, if you're talking about millennials and Gen Zs, they are probably more excited with the idea of working for a socially responsible organization. They're concerned about maybe climate change, about a lot other things, maybe CSR opportunities, etc. So a robust and an adaptable EVP is the one that transforms with the ever-changing needs of the workforce. It can help you secure long-term employer brand in the market. It can help you create that competitive differentiation. And, it can also probably kind of get you to the great place to work. And I'm not saying about the institute, but basically an organization where people would want to work. And in my mind, it is a connected world, 24/7, 365. A consumer brand of an organization overlaps significantly with the employer brand of the organization. How do we nurture an employer brand? How engaged are our existing workforce? Because they are our ambassadors, brand ambassadors. When defining an employer brand, what are the pillars that we are looking at? What are the underlying themes? How are we creating different personas? Like I said, different set of attributes may attract different set of employees to the organization. And building an employer brand and, just relating it back to the candidate experience and, how should we be dealing with it, how an onboarding works. All of this the employer brand runs as a common theme across all of this. Right from when you are interviewing an individual, the individual is also assessing what is the culture, what does the organization stand for. If you're respecting an individual, it is but understandable for an interviewee that they know that the organization has respect as a core value. It will see, and it definitely is something that runs in the DNA of the organization. It is not about one person driving it. It's not about an employer brand team driving it. I think the employer value proposition, which is about culture, which is about our basic principles, our philosophies, it should be embedded in every individual. Every employee is a brand ambassador there. If we look at the COVID situation where people had to, overnight, shift the way they work. How do we define that? Is it an open culture? Was the organization too closed? How do you get into that kind of a mode? What are the channels that you use for engagement? There's social media used all across to build the employer brand. A lot I mean, a lot of organizations are using it, and there are different social media avenues. So that is, whether it is for engagement or whether it is for target messaging, it has become a very important part of that entire employer brand, right? But that is also a double-edged sword. You know, the moment you are on social media, you have to be really careful of what you are putting out there, because the world is so connected, it's so open. Everything that you're saying has to be authentic. If you craft it, at some point of time, somewhere it will show, you know. So in my mind, employer value proposition and the employer brand that we carry is a culmination of how and what your current employees feel about the organization. How are they looking at what are the things that attract them to be with the organization? And what is it that you want from your future workforce whom you're trying to attract? You know, not everybody is probably your target, your target talent pool. So, and leaders, including each employee, plays a very, very important part of this.
Thanks, Raksha. Thanks for putting out these thoughts. And I would like to ask Abhijit now. Raksha mentioned about the double-edged sword and why, you know, social media can be harmful if you are, and what you're putting in what context. So in your views, Abhijit, how can organization boost their talent acquisition strategy through employer branding? And what should they do to avoid damaging the brand when recruiting? You can take from where Raksha left.
Yeah, I think, you know, Raksha basically has put a very strong base, and I completely agree with her on whatever she said. In fact, I could also add in, you know, saying that probably when you're looking at an employer branding, I think that is not different than any other brand, or the values of that is pretty much similar, right? At the end of the day, you would want your employees to be your brand advocates, you know, when they move out, and a lot of thing matters in making sure that you're walking the talk. Okay, so for example, in Cathay, we really believe in an open culture, ensuring that diversity and inclusion, gender equality, and it's not just about saying it. It's about believing, and it's about doing it. So are we making the right policies? Are we doing the right things? To make sure that this is happening. We also believe in let's just say a healthy working environment or given the current challenges that people have. So it is important that we change our policies to make sure that people feel what is happening. So we've, for example, very recently introduced a policy called Work Your Way, okay, which shows people that at the end of the day, when Cathay talks about work-life balance, or when Cathay talks about well-being, it actually means, because this is what we do. When we're talking about diversity and inclusion, we're talking about an ally program that we have, and that ally program, like what Raksha also mentioned, it has to be supported by the right stakeholders. So an ally program actually is where all of us pledge that we will raise our voice when there's something wrong happening, and this pledge actually is starting from our CEO right up to everyone. So, it gives that confidence. And only when you probably give that confidence will you probably have people going and talking outside and saying that, yeah, I think I am working in an organization which probably means what it says. So, one of the things which I would always say is that, if you have and believe in these qualities, I think you need to walk the talk. Okay, you cannot just say these things on paper. It has to come out in everything that you do. Whether it's in the, whether you're talking about all these things when you're recruiting, whether you're showing these and when you're displaying it in the day-to-day working. And only when that happens, probably you'll be able to, get probably the right talent, which probably fits you. In fact, the other example also, which I have is, at Cathay, we believe in sustainability, right? We've pledged a net zero all the way till at 20 to 2050. Now, something like this, it is important, right, to imbibe this right from the time when we are onboarding our candidates. And it's not that, you're just talking about it, once probably in 6 months or 8 months time. And then you need to show things to all our employees on what are the steps that we're taking to make it sure that, you know, we are environmentally conscious and so on and so forth. So I think it's about, you know, not only just putting these things in place, but also, you know, just ensuring that these things are done.
Satyajit, coming back to you, I asked Abhijit to highlight what can employers do to avoid damaging the brand when recruiting. I would like to ask you to focus on a different aspect, that is about employer branding and how can organization boost their talent acquisition strategy through employer branding. Abhijit highlighted about not damaging the part. I would like you to highlight the aspect of boosting their talent acquisition strategy through employer branding.
One word mentioned by you, Abid, and two words mentioned by Raksha. When you asked Raksha a question, you asked the point, attracting the right talent. Raksha spoke about two things, which really struck me in mind. One is differentiated. She used the word differentiated. Your brand should be differentiated from that of the others. Second, she said, is it should be all about what you are as a company. Why I decided to start with these three things is when I was the campus, I'm talking about 20 years back, we used to have all those companies to come and make PPTs. If you take out the logos of the company and the business slides, you know, where somebody is in soap, somebody is in consulting, somebody is in cigarettes, whatever the stuff is, it's almost identical. When the employee part is identical, that's a puzzle. So we saw that in the campus, we would not go out so much by what a Procter & Gamble and Unilever is presenting, but rather what our impressions of Procter & Gamble and Unilever are for ITC was. I joined ITC on the campus itself. So that is the impression stuck in my mind in my formative years. Closer home, when we started this Crompton Greaves consumer company after the demerger from Avanta Group, we have to develop our EVP brand. So as any other of do, let's see what is the kind of prevalent practice in the market. So I personally went to many of the website of well-known companies, looked at their website, EVPs and everything. What I kind of found puzzling is things does not seem to have changed in the last 20 years. Everybody talks about we want to be the best in talent development. We want to give equal opportunity. We are environmentally conscious. We are millennial friendly. All those stuff, it's come on all across. So coming back to topic, when we came back, so first draft we prepared, it was short outright. It was too generic. It doesn't speak about what we are, what Raksha spoke about. So what we came back as a strategy point is, and that will have a significant impact on talent acquisition, is being very crystal clear about what you are, and it should be very simplistic. You can't be 10 things in your EVP slides. Developing talent, social responsible, entrepreneurial, legally compliant, whatever stuff is. Like any strong brand or strong communication, you have to be extremely simple and clear about what you are. And why it is critical is, as Abhijit mentioned and Raksha mentioned, in this current world, the online persona and the offline persona is merging. So there is nothing you can communicate to the people which people cannot understand is fake. So coming back to the talent acquisition strategy, first and foremost is, and that is where what you said, Abhijit, comes in picture, attracting the right talent. A person who may be fit for a Pepsi may not be fit for Crompton. A person fit for Crompton may not be fit for Procter & Gamble. They're all, let's say, they're all good companies, right? So the best thing you can do as a talent acquisition strategy is defy this simple, crisp message of what you are, which should have element, strong element of what you are at this point in time and what your business wants to be in 10 years' time. It has to be a good mix of both the stuff. Once you do that, have all your branding strategy aligned towards this couple of simple messages which you are trying to do. For example, look at Procter & Gamble, Unilever companies, very, very different companies. You attract the kind of people, so if you have communicate around the simple two or three messages a bit, you tend to attract the right kind of people, not necessarily the people who are best in the class or the most qualified or the most accomplished people. And even though those people, when your talent acquisition goes into, they should be evaluating those people on those few fixed parameters. Look at Amazon. Amazon has got 14 values. But you ask what is Amazon is all about, you can probably describe Amazon in two or three sentences. All of us can do the work culture of Amazon can do. extremely operations focused, execution driven, number driven. Their value statement is 14 different statements. So this is the best thing you can do to attract the right kind of talent is, whatever communication you are giving, be it on social media, be it on campus, be it to employees, be it to your shareholders, it should be crafted around these two or three simple messages on what you are and what you want to be in 10 years' time. So you are attracting the right kind of people to your organization. So the, and the best KPI, Abhijit, of course, focus on KPIs. For me, the best indicative KPI for a good talent strategy would be, you know, the way we are defined is the new hire success rate. So if a good person, a person come, doesn't fit in, I take it as not a recruitment process is wrong, of course, maybe wrong, but your talent strategy is, your branding strategy is wrong. You attract a long kind of person because a lot of people are very good at doing interviews. If a person comes, person is good, but we are not, he doesn't like the culture or whatever, then also the failure employer branding itself. So for us, we look at one single KPI, which is a new hire success rate, to measure an indirect impact called the employer branding. We have crafted our branding statement. In fact, a lot of debate on the board about two specific words only. Not one is, you learn by transforming processes. Nothing else. So we have extensive development system, but we don't talk about it. The only way we'll grow in Crumpton is, we are aggressive. We want to change a lot of stuff. So the best learning we provide you by trying to change processes and systems. If you are up for it, please join us. That's a simple talent branding thing we have done, and it has significantly improved. Right now, new hire success rate is 87%, which 3 years back, 4 years back, was hovering around 55 to 60% new hire success rate. So that would be my two bits. I'm still keeping at a higher level. So the strategy level, of course, there are a lot of tools you have in the system right now, which can help in executing this. But unless the overall direction is clear, those tools' effectiveness will be limited.
Thanks, Satyajit, for mentioning your two bits. It's very important. Coming to our third part, that is onboarding, especially virtual onboarding. Anjali, I have a question for you. You know, we are talking about virtual onboarding. There's a mindset that tech has a vital role to play in virtual onboarding. But the other theory suggests that humans are irreplaceable. What do you think, who according to you holds the secret sauce, tech or human, and why?
I think human still holds the secret sauce, and I'll tell you why. I'll give you an example. Last year, in the middle of pandemic, we had to onboard 47 management trainees in the organization, and like most of the organization, the whole tussle was in between, you know, amid the pandemic, first of all, onboarding, and that to 47 numbers, we were also a bit worried in terms of the experience and everything. So while what tech does for you is helps you in structuring the whole program, right? You have the technology, you have the platform, you use tools to engage them, because these are people from campuses and they've had a very different experience, and suddenly they are in a very formal setup where there is a CEO coming in and addressing them, a CFO is coming in and addressing them. So it was also about keeping it and making it very engaging for them. So that's where technology played the maximum part for us. We were able to bring spin the wheel kind of a game, like, so that you are awake in the class. So what do we do is, like, anybody's name will just pop up on the screen and you have to tell what has been spoken so far, right? So people tend to be a little bit more attentive in the thing rather than switching off the video and going off it. So those were some things. Jamboard, we use jamming, breakout rooms to give them a little bit of break from, you know, the monotonous one-on-one dialogues that were happening. So those were the places where technology was very, very useful. But where the human touch came into the picture was really the engagement that we built in. So look at it. These are people who are sitting in their houses and they're, for the first time, they're onboarding with an organization. Very few of them had 1 or 2 years of experience. Most were, for them, it was like the first time experience. So we really kind of ensured that they had one-on-one conversations too, right? Because in a group, sometimes you are shy. You could be an introvert and you don't want to ask a question in front of others. So what we did was we made them have peer conversation, and peer with their own seniors from previous year colleges who have joined us and who are there in the system. So they could open up a little bit more. We also created networks of their own so that within their own batch, they can actually ask questions. And we made them one of them like a sort of a class monitor, how you used to have, right? So that they can actually address the things to them. And then, you know, somehow we are kind of ensuring we are taking care of them as well. Plus, sending them the right, you know, content for them to know the organization better. And as everyone has been speaking about the EVP, for us at Randstad, it's about making work meaningful, right? So whatever you might be doing, wherever you might be, it's about, do you find meaning in the work that you do? So our structure was a lot around that, in being a recruiter, being a business development person, being an account manager, how do you bring value to the organization? And I say leadership plays a very, very big role over here, because one, is there can be two kinds of organization. One where leadership is completely off this process and there is a stakeholder who's running it. The other thing is you being a leader, fully being involved over there, gives a very different experience to somebody who's coming for the first time in the organization. So how do you create that warmth? And being so far away, how do you bring belongingness, connect, and celebration in the whole process? So I think our focus was a lot around that. We celebrated, we had them assessed with simple games so that the learning objectives were being met. And at the same time, connect was brought through a lot of leadership conversations, a lot of peer-to-peer, manager-to-manager conversation, mentors, guides, really coming in into the process. At the end of the process, when we took feedback from these people to see whether they really felt at home within the organization, the feedback was amazing. And in fact, I would say in the world of employer branding, more than an organization going out and speaking about all the great work that they are doing, employees are the best brand ambassadors that you can have. And they took on to the social media to talk about their experience that they had in the onboarding, not just about the kit that they got, but about what they felt during the process, how much they feel part of the organization. I think that enhances your brand value far higher than you going and saying, hey, I onboarded 47 people, we tried giving them a great experience, right? So I think this is what happened. And I'm a big believer, human plays a huge role. It's that tech, it becomes your enabler in the whole process. If you have great technology, you end up giving a great experience, but it's the heart and the mind which plays the bigger role for us. So that's how the experience went. And it was a great learning for us. We were hesitant in the beginning, but then that experience gave us the confidence that we can continue the virtual onboarding, and it's not that they won't feel a part of the organization. So that's been our journey. That's one example I thought I'll share over here in terms of how onboarding has been. And I think most organizations do 30, 60, 90, the buddy programs, those continue to ensure that the employee assimilation process, you being part of the organization from a technical work, plus your settling in the organization was also taken care of.
Raksha, I have a different question for you. From your point of view, I'd like to ask, I spoke to Anjali and she shared some very good points and I have noted, and what she mentioned that people are your biggest brand ambassadors. That will stay with me, I think. So Raksha, what are some of the best practices of virtual onboarding? I would like to share a few with our audiences.
Sure. Now, when you talk about onboarding, actually onboarding starts from probably the time that the person accepts an offer, a candidate accepts the offer. You know, some organizations call it pre-onboarding. Some, you know, there are different names that we use, but it probably starts from there, because that's from where you start ensuring that the individual starts imbibing your culture, understands how an organization operates. So how do you make that happen? You know, there are organizations which do pre-onboarding portals, pre-joining portals, where you have some leaders talks, some recent events about the organization which has happened, some alumni connect options, etc. So that is where you start building that connect. When it comes to virtual onboarding, it's a culmination of a lot of things, you know, right from having the right, the way the entire day or 2 days or 3 days, depending on how the organization is looking at onboarding, is structured, from enabling an individual to be able to connect with the network. It's as simple as that, you know. Some organizations ensure that the IT equipment, etc., reach the candidates before. Some probably send it after, and some also have given the lockdowns, etc., that we are in, there have been situations where the organizations have asked individuals to start working on their personal laptops. Doesn't matter. I mean, you know, these are all challenging situations, but how well you communicate with the individual, if the individual knows whom to reach out to, where to reach out for something, I think that's a very, very, very important part, because it's all virtual. The person hasn't ever seen You know, if I come to SAP, our campus is such a beautiful campus. There's so much of, you know, the energy, there's so much of culture, there's so much of belongingness that an employee could feel the moment the employee walks in. We don't have that choice now. We have to onboard everybody virtually. So how do you build your entire thing around it? Have somebody, you know, to talk to. It could be a buddy, it could be a manager, but ensure that the person knows that there is somebody whom the individual can reach out to. Build that belongingness. So the entire thing should be built around helping employees understand the organization, the nitty-gritties, like, you know, say tribal knowledge. You don't get tribal knowledge by having a formal meeting. You know, the tribal knowledge is generally passed on when you're talking, when you're on the coffee corners, etc. How do you make that happen? How do you make that sense of belongingness happen? So when a virtual onboarding is structured around all of this, using technology, using human intervention, and how much, and it can be also elongated. So in certain cases, we've seen that we've had, let's say, 1 day onboarding completely, and then maybe follow it up with 2 hours of sessions with the leaders, Q&A, informal connects with the leaders, etc. All of that helps build the entire structure and helps employees assimilate. The objective of an onboarding session is to help employees assimilate. It is not about paperwork. It's about helping employees assimilate, understand what the organization is all about, what works in an organization, what doesn't work in an organization. You know, when I have personally worked in different organizations, what works in an organization A does not probably work in an organization B. Each organization has some clearly stated out, but some unsaid rules as well. You know, the entire program should be so designed that these elements are captured. You know, there are certain selling points of an organization. How do you make sure that your employee who's joined you on day one becomes your brand advocate from that day? So as I said, it starts much before that. How do you make the individual feel before the person is joining in and when the person has joined in? You know, it was very easy when you're walking in into a office facility. You know, there are welcome kits, there are people greeting you. There are 100 things that organizations do to ensure that the employee feels wanted. I think that's the element that should be absolutely at the center. You know, how does the employee feel? What makes the person wanted? And at the same time, ensuring that we communicate what we as an organization stand for in all our communication, because that's when the employee will be able to actually contribute, actually understand, and not kept, you know, not left thinking that what is it that I should be doing in such a situation? If I'm in such a situation, what should I be doing? No, there should be communication, and the employee should get to know where these are the 5 top places or people that you can reach out to if you're stuck.
Thank you, Raksha, for putting everything in details, everything from employee kit to onboarding. I would like to ask Abhijit my last question, that is for Abhijit. You know, Abhijit, onboarding new employees completely virtually is a new concept, like 1 year old concept for most employers. Many companies are struggling to make it seamless, dynamic, and informative. So as a people leader, as an HR professional, what would be your suggestions to them? Any do's and don'ts or any personal suggestions? What are your suggestions?
Sure. I think it something like this matters a lot for you know, a company like Cathay, because and I think Anjali and Raksha both have touched upon this in some way or the other, whether how you're, you know, blending the whole virtual and the personal experience. For us, if I have to talk about Cathay, you know, we have a very robust onboarding program, in the sense, not just what I just mentioned in the process, but once the person is on board, or when the candidate is on board, we actually have, we believe that, you know, she or he should completely experience what the brand is. So, you know, we have a Brushwingers program. Brushwingers is actually the logo that you see on Cathay. And that program actually is where we send our candidates to our hub in Hong Kong. So, you know, they get a feel of the product that we have, whether it's economy, premium economy, or business class. What are the catering services that we have? What are the lounges that we have? Then they meet various leaders there. They get time to spend with people from different cultures, because, you know, they're just not just from say India, but they're from different other many people are from other countries also. Now, a virtual setup like this obviously then becomes a bit challenging. But one of the things that we are very conscious are that, you know, this the process that we have is going to be is important and to basically make these people our brand ambassadors, right? So we cannot exclude this. And that is why what we've done is we've actually built a virtual website, and this is very separate from what we have. And this access is given only to the new candidates. So the whole entire Brushfingers program is actually taken on the virtual platform. What we've also done is we've understand that, you know, to have something like this in 8 or 9 hours time, you know, which we used to have in person is not going to be possible right now. So we've actually broken that into, you know, smaller sessions. There are videos, there are shorter games, there are quizzes on board. They also get a chance to interact with you know, their peers or their colleagues from different parts of the world. Then there are smaller sessions which you know, people are able to interact with the senior leadership, which is based in Hong Kong. So what then happens is you're doing something very similar, but on a virtual platform. So what has happened is probably the time to do the virtual or this onboarding process has increased from, say, probably 2 days or 3 days to probably almost a month and a half or two. But at the end of the day, at least we are ensuring that, you know, our core brand values are instilled in our employees, because as everyone's talking about, you know, if we want our employees to be brand ambassadors, I don't think so we should be, you know, moving away from what our core belief is. And our core belief is this, that, you know, the experience that they should have should be a complete one.
Thanks a lot, everyone. But before we sum up, I would like to ask one question. You can share answering one word or one line, not more than that. What are the key takeaways from this session? You all spoke really well. I think I'll start. My key takeaway was, you know, your people are your brand advocates. So I'll start with Satyajit.
What Anjali said, believe in a lot. Virtual onboarding or getting people is all about relationships.
Okay, relations. Raksha.
Experiences matter.
Anjali.
Give a human forward experience to your candidates.
Great. And Abhijit.
Yeah. Believe in your people because they are your brand.
Another one from Believe in People because they are your brand. Thanks a lot, everyone. It's my pleasure to hosting you. And thanks a lot.